Hello everyone, this is the part 3 of module 5 series. The present presentation contains the last topics of welding defects and inspection methods, wherein we are going to discuss about the different types of welding defects and the non-destructive inspection methods. Welding defects. As you all know, welding is also a part of fabrication process. Like casting, welding also involves various parameters like the type of workpiece material, electrode material, power source, heat input, cooling rate, welding speed, etc. Loss of control in any one of these parameters causes the defect in the weld metal. Most of the defects encountered in welding are due to improper welding procedures. Some common defects are crack, distortion, incomplete penetration, inclusions, porosity, undercut, lack of fusion, etc. Let's see one by one. The first one is a crack. As you can see, the first figure shows you the crack on the slide. Crack is a small sharp split that occurs in the base metal, weld metal, or at the interface between the two and are visible to naked eye. It is considered as a serious defect because these cracks are also known as stress risers, which are capable to grow until the fracture takes place. Coming to the causes for this particular type of defect, incorrect technique for ending the weld, poor ductility of the base metal, combination of joint design and welding techniques, low welding currents, and restrained joints, that is, the joint members are not free to expand and contract when subjected to heat. Some of the second type of welding defect is distortion. As you can see in the figure 7.5b, it is called as distortion. Distortion is the change in the original shape of the two workpiece after welding. As you can see, instead of flat, it has raised to a certain angle. The causes being high residual stresses due to shrinkage, high heat input, multiple number of passes, slow welding speed. And the third one is incomplete penetration. When the molten metal fails to penetrate the entire thickness of the base plate, it forms a bridge across the two plates, causing the defect in the weld. That is, inability to fill the gap between two work pieces. That is called as incomplete penetration. Some of the common causes are improper joint design, low welding current, low arc travel, and incorrect torch angle. Next defect is inclusion. Inclusions are usually non-metallic particles such as slag or any foreign material that does not get a chance to float on the surface of the solidifying metal, and thus it gets entrapped inside the weld. Common causes are use of large electrodes in a narrow groove, low current that is insufficient for melting metal, high viscosity of the weld metal. Next is porosity. Porosities are small voids or cavities that are formed when gases are trapped in the solidifying weld metal. Porosity can either occur under or over the weld. Causes are atmospheric contamination due to inadequate shielding gas, excessive oxidized workpiece surface, use of wet electrodes, excessive gas release during welding. The next defect is undercut. Undercut, the worst of all defects, is the term given to the shaft narrow groove along the toe of the weld due to the scoring action of the arc, removing the metal and not replacing it with the weld metal. As you can see in the figure 7.5F, on the vertical plate, weld plate, there is a small groove which has not been filled by the weld metal. Such defects are called as undercut. The causes are high voltage and welding current, high arc travel speed, incorrect electrode manipulation, arc gap too long. And the last one is lack of fusion, or sometimes it's also called as overlapping. Lack of fusion is the failure of the welding process to fuse together layers of the base metal. The weld metal just rolls over the workpiece surface. The common causes are low welding currents, excessive surface impurities on the workpiece, improper electrode type or size, wrong polarity, and low arc. Inspection methods. Inspection is an art or process which involves taking dimensions, observation of correctness of operations, and examining the presence or the extent of imperfection in a fabricated part to ensure whether the part conforms to the design requirements. There are different inspection methods. Some common methods are dimensional inspection, metallurgical inspection, mechanical inspection, and non-descriptive inspection. Coming to dimensional inspection, we are using some instruments to check the dimensions, such as micrometers, automatic gauges, etc., of the part against the drawing. Second one is metallurgical inspection. Specific equipment like disc sectioning machine, specimen mounting press, grinding, polishing, turntables, some acid etching capabilities, and an optical metallurgical microscope with magnification capacity is required for metallurgical inspection. Weld bead shape, discontinuities, metallographic phases in different areas of the weld, and cast metal can be obtained by this method of inspection. Next is mechanical inspection, also known as destructive inspection. The name destructive inspection is because of the parts to be inspected are partly or completely damaged during inspection. Various properties of the material like tensile strength, compression strength, shear strength, hardness, impact strength, etc. can be evaluated from this method of inspection. Next is non-destructive inspection. Non-destructive inspection involves assessing the soundness and acceptability of the part without destroying or altering the structure of the fabricated part. Internal defects like cracks, flaws, blowholes, etc. can be effectively determined by this method. The various tests involved in non-destructive inspection are visual inspection, magnetic particle inspection, fluorescent particle inspection, ultrasonic inspection, radiography inspection, eddy current inspection, and holographic inspection. We'll look into that. Before going to magnetical particle inspection, we'll just discuss about visual inspection first. Visual inspection is the most widely used method of all non-destructive tests. It is a simple test that consumes less time but is useful only to detect the presence of defects on the surface of the fabricated part. The part is illuminated with light and examined with naked eye, sometimes with a magnifying lens or a low power microscope. Visual inspection is often overlooked, but it provides good information about surface defects like cracks, porosity, fusion, edge melt, incomplete penetration, etc. Next, coming to magnetic particle inspection. This method uses magnetic fields and small magnetic particles to detect the surface defects or near surface defects in ferrous material. The figure shows the principle of magnetic particle inspection. The entire inspection is divided into two stages. The first stage is the magnetizing the part. The part to be inspected should be cleaned thoroughly and held between two copper dams as shown in the figure. When a high current is passed through the part, magnetic flux is produced at right angles to the flow of current. If the material is sound or defect free, most of the magnetic flux is concentrated below the material surface. However, If a discontinuity or defect is present in the part, the magnetic flux gets diverted and leaks through the surface of the part, creating the magnetic force. The crack edge becomes the magnetic attractive force, north and south, as shown in the figure. The second part is the detection of the defect. The presence of leakage of field and therefore the presence of discontinuity is detected by dusting finely divided iron oxide powder on the surface so that the particles cling to the leakage area, indicating the location of discontinuity. Next NDT method is fluorescent penetrant inspection. Fluorescent penetrant method of inspection is used for testing the parts made with ferrous and non-ferrous materials. The process is preferred for the parts with discontinuous like cracks, porosity, shrinkage, etc. that are clear and open to the surface. The entire inspection is divided in 5 stages. The first stage is surface preparation, where the part has to be cleaned thoroughly to remove the dirt, oxide and other impurities. Second is the application of penetrant. Penetrant is nothing but a colored fluorescent liquid that is applied onto the surface of the part being tested, either by dipping, brushing or spraying. After sufficient time is allowed, the penetrant easily enters into the flaw due to the capillary action and low surface tension. The third stage is removing excess penetrant. The excess penetrant on the part surface is washed away with water or a solvent and then dried with air. Care should be taken that penetrant should not be removed from the flaw. Fourth stage is developer application. A developer is a form of dry powder or suspension of powder in liquid which is applied on the surface. The developer acts like a blotter and draws the penetrant out of the flaw. And the final stage is inspection. The part is inspected in dark enclosure under ultraviolet or black light. The blotted out fluorescent particles will give a visible glow under the ultraviolet light, revealing the presence of the defect. This is very effective in machined and finished parts. Ultrasonic inspection. Ultrasonic inspection is used to detect surface and subsurface defects in both ferrous and non-ferrous materials. The diagram on the slide shows you the testing procedure. The steps involved are, initially, as usual, the surface of the workpiece to be tested should be cleaned thoroughly. The transducer is placed above the workpiece, which converts electrical energy into mechanical vibrations and vice versa. The sound energy from the transducer propagates through the couplant and strikes the upper surface of the workpiece metal in the form of waves. The waves from the upper surface travel and strike the other end of the surface of the workpiece and will be reflected back to the transducer. In other words, the transducer sends the waves and also receives the reflected waves. The reflected waves are transformed into electrical signals by the transducer and are displayed on a cathode ray oscilloscope on the screen, which can be seen as a sharp peak, the point A on the figure. When the propagating wave strikes a defect, the wave gets reflected in midway back to transducer, and as a result, an echo is displayed at point B on the CRO before another echo given by the wave at the point C striking at the far end of the jaw. Therefore, imperfections or other conditions in the space between the transmitter and receiver reduces the amount of sound transmitted, thus revealing their presence. The echo at point B is an indication of the defect present in the workpiece. Ultrasonic inspection not only helps to identify the defect but also gives information on location, size and distance from the surface of the workpiece, orientation and other features of the defect. radiography inspection. Radiography inspection is also known as X-ray inspection and is one of the oldest and widely used methods for detecting subsurface cracks and inclusions both in ferrous and non-ferrous materials. When the X-ray is deviated to pass through the workpiece material containing a defect, since the defect possesses low density, they transmit X-rays better than the adjacent sound metal that possesses high density. The X-rays after passing through the workpiece are allowed to fall in a light sensitive film placed at a suitable distance behind the workpiece. Interpretation of X-ray film is not only about distinguishing between the areas of film blackness. Defects in the forms of cracks and voids are recorded as blackened areas on the film compared to the existing portions of less blackened areas. Eddy current inspection. Eddy current inspection uses the principle of electromagnetism as a basis for conducting examination. When a circular coil, also called as probe, carrying alternating current is brought near the workpiece metal, a magnetic field of the coil will induce circulating eddy currents in the workpiece surface, as shown in the figure. The magnitude and the phase of the eddy current will affect the loading on the coil and thus its impedance. If there is some defect such as crack in the workpiece, the eddy current will be disturbed from the normal circular pattern as shown in the figure. This will reduce the eddy current flow, thereby decreasing the loading on the coil and increasing its effective impedance. The resulting change in phase and magnitude of the eddy current can be displayed on a cathode ray tube display. This gives the operator the ability to identify the defect condition in the workpiece. The size of the defect can also be determined by certain extent. Holographic inspection. The present slide shows you the figure of optical holographic for surface deformation inspection. In holographic techniques, the test sample is interferometrically compared with the sample after it has been stressed or loaded. A flaw can be detected if by stressing the object it creates an anomalous deformation of the surface around the flaw. Optical holography is an imaging method which records the amplitude and the phase of the light reflected to form an object as an interferometric pattern on the film. It thus allows the reconstruction of the full 3D image of the object. In this test, the sample is interferometrically compared in two different stress states. Stressing can be mechanical, thermal, or vibration, etc. The resulting interference pattern contours the deformation undergone by the specimen in between the two recordings. Surface as well as subsurface defects show distortions in otherwise uniform pattern. In addition, the characteristics of the components such as vibration modes, mechanical properties, residual stresses, etc. can be identified through holographic inspections.